We're honored to have as our guest the ambassador of Russia to the United States, His Excellency Dr. Lukin. Dr. Lukin was educated at the Moscow Pedagogical Institute. He did his postgraduate work with the Institute for World Economy and International Relations, part of the Academy of Sciences of the USSR. He was posted as a journalist in Prague, 1965 to 1968. And he was asked to come home after he publicly protested the intervention of the Russian military in that country in 1968. For the next 20 years, he worked with the Institute on USA-Canada Studies, and in 1990 was elected as a People's Deputy. He is also one of the co-authors of the Statement of Independence or Sovereignty of Russia. He became ambassador to the United States in 1992. We're delighted that an authoritative figure is with us at this critical moment. We look forward, of course, to with great interest to the future developments between our two great countries. The President will be meeting with President Yeltsin on the 4th of April, which will be pivotal, and we are delighted to welcome him as our guest this evening. Ambassador Lukin.
Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. It is a great privilege to me to be here. I consider your city as a close neighbor.
Can't hear you.
Yes? Maybe it is Japanese technique, eh? No, I don't know. Third party is being involved in our relationship. Okay. Now, I try to be as close to to a mic as possible. It is a honor to me to be here because I consider Baltimore as the closest neighbor of my now capital, Washington, D.C. And it happens that the closest neighbors are being visited later than distant areas, distant cities. But I was here four or five times, and now I am invited to your distinguished council. And I know that it is largest in the city and in the country, and it is a honor to me to be here. Actually, my main profession is not a diplomat. I'm a scholar in international relations. And that is why it is a special pleasure to speak in the audience where there are, as I presume, many colleagues. It is my subject today may be divided in two parts. One is some general remarks actually I would answer a question: how stable now is Russian-American relations? Russian-American relations, Soviet-American relations were stable, but it is stable. It was a stable confrontational relations. How stable partnership is possible between our countries? Both of them are democratic countries. Well, maybe a short answer, yes. And the second part will be, I try to pretend that I know answers on your questions. I presume there will be questions after my short and general remarks. Well, the short answer to this question, how stable is Russian-American relations now, is it all depends. But this clearly would be quite correct, but not to be enough. to let me elaborate. So to let me elaborate on some of the key factors of this relationship. As any other bilateral relationship, it depends, first of all, upon both sides. Their relationship, their leadership, and internal situation, as well as other international conditions. The biggest and the most problematic variable here is, of course, Russia herself, the way she evolves vis-a-vis the United States. What are the possible options now? But first, let me a little bit tell about non-options. One is a return to the Cold War type confrontation, which is impossible for many reasons, including a contraction of Russian military technological power and her geostrategic base. At the same time, one shouldn't underestimate a demonstrated ability of the Russian people to quickly recreate a huge military machine under adverse circumstances. A second non-option is the opposite to the first. Once I described it as a romantic, infantile pro-Americanism on our side. And this phrase has been haunting me ever since. Some people, both here and in Russia, even put me on a blacklist of a closet anti-Americanist and other right-wingers. Still, I continue to think that this notion of our partnership, which basically sees Russia as an just obedient vessel of the United States, is unrealistic and harmful for both sides. It is unrealistic if only because it is politically unsustainable for Russia, as it would be for any other great power. It is harmful for Russia because it deprives her of an independent foreign policy and encourages xenophobic ultra-nationalist backlash. And it is harmful for the United States for the same reason, plus because it leaves it with no real base inside Russia for a stable long-term relationship. Because only few people think that Russia should be devoid of their own foreign policy. This U-turn from a habitual Cold War hostility to a new romantic affection was psychologically quite understandable and perhaps even unavoidable for us. But both hatred and affection, as George Washington instructed us almost 200 years ago, make a slave out of a country indulging in those passions, and of which is any of which is capable of leading it astray from its own duty and interest. A stable, long-term partnership can be built only on common interest properly understood. This realization, this striving for a more independent, self-centered, and interest-based foreign policy is growing in Russia now, submerging the early romantic ideology of vague, uncertain, and full internationalism. Some nativization or nationalization, if you wish, of Russian foreign policy is inevitable. The real question is what forms this process will take and how far it will go, given a deepening sense of national humiliation and victimization which nourishes a growing ultra-nationalist backlash. One way to deal with this backlash is to reject it, either through ignoring or trying to suppress it, even by unconstitutional means. The other way is to flirt with it and to appease it. Both of these ways, in my view, are counterproductive and would essentially produce the same result, yielding political ground and initiative to the real right forces. But there is still another, and I would call it the Gallist way, which is preempt and marginalize this backlash by taking the values of national interest, identity, and greatness away from the right. In other words, Democrats, in my view, should become the chief custodians of the new Russian statehood. Not Soviet, but Russian statehood. This is, in my view, is the only way to preserve democracy in Russia and to secure a democratic definition of Russian national interests. And those interests, in a democratic interpretation, would not seriously clash with basic interests of the United States, just on the contrary. It will coincide with them in many areas. So, if you ask me what is the best alternative to what I name as romantic infantile pro-Americanism in Russian foreign policy, I would say it is a mature, realistic pro-Americanism. Of course, to be politically correct in Russia, it should have a quite different name. But the substance based upon our common interest would remain. The main thing is that this policy, as any viable national policy, should begin with the interest of your own country. And it is absolutely natural for you. Just as you have concluded that assisting Russian democracy is in your own interest, so we must realize that become convinced in practice that a cooperation with the United States, as well as other Western democratic countries, is the best way to secure our own interest in the world. It does not mean that our interest would not differ or even at times collide. Differences and occasional conflicts are inevitable, even between close allies. Remember your experience with Japan, with France, with some other unquestionably democratic and Western countries. The difference, and but it means that these differences would be subordinated to a long-term commonality of basic interests and would be resolved in a civilized and amicable fashion. An alternative strategy, especially if Russian democratic development is stalled, maybe Russian alliance with the anti-Western third world countries playing on the contradictions within the West itself, shall we say, between United States, Germany, Japan, as well as China. In other words, a protection of Russian security interests, not together with, but rather in spite of the United States. In which case, these interests themselves would be redefined in a more traditionalistic and imperial way. And we should, real Democrats, should withstand it with skillful and methods which are understandable to our people and acceptable to our people. Which of these alternatives would prevail is mostly up to us, depending upon our general course of development, but not solely up to us. And here, let me deal briefly with the American factor of our Russian-American relationship. First, about your general attitude and understanding of our situation. It is a very dynamic, complex, and the stakes involved are very great. So, to keep up with it, both we and you should be very attentive, flexible, and patient. The temptations of simplify, personalize, and schematize have been and will be very strong, as well as a temptation to look down on the exhausted Russia as a junior partner at best, and to squeeze out of this partnership as much and as quickly as possible, regardless of the long-term consequences. Such a formula of partnership may give you some short-term benefits, But in the long run, it is bound to be counterproductive. Not only because nations like individuals have their own pride and memory, but also because this is the shortest way to politically isolate your best friends in Russia and to provide ammunition for your worst enemies inside the country. Of course, bluntly speaking, Russia is a junior partner now, given her present shape. But precisely because of that, and also because she is a new and still very fragile partner, she needs a special treatment, even though it may be not proportionate to her current power and influence. There is also another, even more dangerous temptation for the United States and the West as a whole, which I would call a fatigue escape syndrome. The Russian chaos, which is described so eloquently in your newspapers, I don't know how about Baltimore Sun, but in some others, well, is growing. It is not new and exciting anymore, solutions in Russia, in Russian problems. Solution of Russian problems are murky and not so certain. There seems to be very little that the West and even the Russians themselves can do to stop this drift. Besides, there are so many problems at home, I mean your home. So selfish prudence and some armchair strategies are offering a logical response to disengage from Russia, except perhaps for encouraging words and strictly nuclear weapons matters, and to limit the damage by containing the Russian disease within Russian borders. This would be recklessness disguised as prudence. Isolating and abandoning Russia is likely to become a self-fulfilling prophecy, producing precisely the kind of threat the West is most worried about. This may happen not by intent, but almost by default, through a vicious spiral of interaction in which each step by one side would be reinforced the worst suspicions of the other and lead to a similar response. So, active engagement and assistance on the part of the West are absolutely indispensable. But what kind of assistance? As of now, the United States, it seems to me, is having the worst of both worlds. By confining its efforts to IMF structural adjustment formula, it inadvertently, first, assumes certain responsibility for the overall direction of economic reform in our country. Second, becomes identified with a painful and malfunctioning policy. And third, gets very little credit from the Russians, since they see few positive tangible results of American assistance. To overcome this, some diversification of assistance and change of emphasis can be in order. Why not shift from the macroeconomic manipulation to the real help on the microeconomic level of specific industries, enterprises, farmers, economies, zones, etc. This shift of emphasis from the trickle-down reform to the trickle-up reform may be more effective in making reforms irreversible in our country. And it may be much more rewarding politically, since it would de-emphasize American responsibility for their overall direction of reform, while in the eyes of Russian public, it would transform the United States from an outsider dictating harsh economic conditions to an inside partner providing real help in economic restoration of Russia. We fully understand that you face huge problems at home and other crises abroad. that gays cannot wait, that Somalia is desperate, and that something should be done about Bosnia. But consider the amount of time spent by the United States government on these problems and on Russia as compared with the strategic stakes that United States has in each and those cases, and you will see the illogic of the situation until now. Of course, it is natural for a democracy to respond first to immediate political pressures and threats. It is the task for the leadership to focus on fundamental priorities of national policy and to educate the public about these realities. If a powerful case is made about the significance of Russian future for the United States strategic, political, and economic interest, as well as for its domestic renewal, I am sure that American public will understand and support this engagement. At any rate, Russia, among other things, is a major test for and for an ability of American democracy to respond to critical long-term challenges. In analyzing Russian-American relations, it is customary these days to view Russia as a huge question mark and the United States as a constant and invariable. I have already tried to show that it is not quite so. But there is another, more long-term aspect of American factor, namely the state of American society itself. The American exceptionalism, notwithstanding, United States is a part of the world, sharing some common problems with Russia. For instance, the identity crisis in a multinational, multi-ethnic society, and how to keep this society together in the face of growing socio-economic balkanization. And what about a third worlderization of certain part of America itself? Or the inability of a democratic political system to absorb sacrifices and adjustments necessary for the long-term economic health of your society? The ways these challenges are handled have a lot of impact on your foreign policy, including relations with Russia. Last month, we organized a conference in our embassy called America and Russian Future. It was largely publicized. Perhaps, maybe the next should be called Russia and America, America's Future. And I will be, with a great pleasure, invite some of you to attend and speak at this conference. And finally, a few words about the global factors of our relationship. Again, it is fashionable these days to ascribe most of the new threats and instability to the end of communism and the Cold War. But it goes much beyond that. There are global technological, demographic, ethnocultural, and other destabilizing forces at work, some of which Paul Kennedy described as well as in the new book. I strongly recommend to read it to all those who are interested in the global problems. It will be more and more difficult to maintain some sort of a sane world order and that would be safe for democracy. Russia is only part of this larger problem, but she is also a good part of its solution. For I am deeply convinced that without a stable and democratic Russia, and without a working and lasting and stable Russian-American partnership, there can be no reasonable, secure world. Thank you very much.
Mr. Ambassador, we thank you very much. The floor is now open for questions until 10 minutes after 7. I'll repeat those questions which are asked from the floor for the benefit of the camera. Yes, sir, at the microphone.
we'll...
Another mic doesn't function.
Start at this mic then. If
now it is Korean one. Hmm?
Yes.
Your Excellency, you had made several observations about the current state of American democracy and some of the troubles that we're experiencing along with some of the other mature democracies like the UK and Canada. And I was wondering if the problems that we are experiencing now with the lack of faith in our political institutions and economic institutions are informing the development of Russian political institutions. Are you learning from the mistakes that we've made a little further along the curve?
Well, it is very natural. We learn your democratic experience and find that this experience is very rich, very useful, but there is nothing perfect in this world. And we try to do our best not to reach this not perfect, but very good and very viable democratic society.
Of course. Yes, sir, at the microphone.
Your Excellency, I'd just like to know what your government's views dealing with nuclear proliferation are, especially in regards to North Korea and China, and how willing would your nation be to sell nuclear technology for hard currency?
Nuclear proliferation now is becomes more and more maybe the most important international problem in the area of disarmament, and we understand it pretty well. And we try to do everything we can to cooperate with your country in taking up this burden and understanding and researching and dealing with this problem. Actually, China cannot be considered as an issue of proliferation because China is, a codified and legitimate nuclear power, and China has nuclear weapons, but there were suspicions that China provides somebody, let us say, Pakistan or somebody else. Now, system of control, international control is acting, is an action, and China refuses absolutely definitely that he is involved in it. Korea is a real problem, North Korea, I mean. It is a real problem. We press North Korea very hard to accept all the systems of control. Quite recently, our deputy foreign minister, Mr. Kunadze, who deals with oriental issues, visited Korea, and there were very, very intensive talk with the North Korean authorities on the subject. Now, it seems to me that some ice is going to be broken because Korean Minister of Atomic Energy is going to go to Geneva to participate in discussions. But if we will withstand the resistance, we will act in cooperation with the United States with this issue. There are some other issues, by the way, Ukrainian problem in this area. But you didn't ask me, and I thank you for this.
Yes, sir.
Mr. Ambassador, I had a related question. In January, Yevgeny Primakov said that halting the transfer of weapons of mass destruction from Russia to countries in the Third World was a high priority. However, there have been reports that such transfers have been made recently. Does Russia abide by regimes such as the missile technology control regime, and if not, why not?
Russia abides by all agreement which it signed. Russia did not sign agreement on missile technology control, and but we accepted this regime and we comply with this. What is the problem is that our state enterprise concluded agreement with India, on some missile technology transfer, which is banned for to export not by international agreement, but by the United States law, by the United States legislation. Of course, we are very much respect United States, but we are still independent states, though we are the most peace-loving country in the world because we don't interfere sometimes in our own internal affairs. But but we are still independent, and that is why we act in accordance with our own laws. So there was a dispute in this area, and the United States prohibit contacts between this our this our state enterprise Glove Cosmos and American enterprises for 3 years. Now negotiations are underway. What is acceptable and what is unacceptable for both sides in this very gray and uncertain area of technology? I cannot tell you about it because I am ignorant in all these technicalities, but what I know that negotiations are underway, and I think that we finally find a way to accept both American understanding of it and Russian understanding. There is a real difference of approaches on the, I would say, on the technical level.
Thank you.
Yes, sir. Mr. Ambassador, back to Yugoslavia. I think both our countries are equally troubled as to what's going on in Yugoslavia right now. And you mentioned you always had a special relationship with Serbia. Is it possible that Russia could lead the way towards peace in that area with your good offices and the specific relationship or the special relationship you do have in that area of the world?
Well, I don't know whether we can lead this way. The situation is very complicated, as you know. But I am sure that we will have to be very active and very positive in trying to cooperate with everybody, and first and foremost with the United States, with European countries, in resolving this mess. What is difficult for me, frankly, to understand is how simple decisions are instrumental in dealing with this problem. For example, problem on non-flying zone. Well, I understand that it is very pleasant for some part of American public, which accustomed to watch by TV Star Wars, to see how good our American American plane strike the some vehicle on Earth or some play of so-called bad guys. It is very good. But tell me, please, how it is? How can it be helpful in resolving this mess on Earth, on land, when in the mountains, when there are many, many, many different forces are in action, when in every this group the local commanders are not so obedient to the superior commanders, regional commanders, and the regional commanders are not so obedient to the tribal leaders, and so on, tribal leaders to the national authority, and all this mess, how it will help? It will only mobilize the nationalistically minded people against this foreign symbol. That is the problem. So what we discuss is not whether or not it is good or not to somehow collaborate, to somehow actively participate in elaboration of the conflict. But we know what civil war is. Your civil war was long ago. Our civil war was closer. And we know that there are not rights and wrongs in civil war. Tell me, please, who was more cruel in our civil war, Reds or Whites? Poles and Greens also, local commanders. You know? So it is a very difficult problem, and it needs very cautious and very difficult, very effective decisions. I think that your former state secretary, Mr. Vance, and Lord Owen, who are plunged into this mess many months ago are close to understanding these complexities. And some new guys say, well, I'm very good. Let us resolve it by one strike, by another strike. That is a problem. And we discuss that problem, and we'll begin to understand each other.
Yes, sir.
Mr. Ambassador, while the attention was focused during the Cold War on American and Russian or American and Soviet relations because they were the two poles, so to speak, of the adversity, in peaceful situations, it would seem to me to be more natural, or at least somewhat more natural, for Russia to look to Europe as its natural companion in trying to develop its economy as its natural trading area and so forth, and even to look to for technical expertise, industrial expertise, since they're part of European history as their neighbors. And yet I don't hear a whole lot in the news about that. I mean, has Europe sort of lost interest in the Soviet Union since they're no longer afraid of Soviet tanks, or rather in Russia, excuse me, they're no longer afraid of tanks rolling over them, or just what is the state of Russia's relations with Europe vis-a-vis economics, and also how is Russia approaching membership in the various international organizations and bodies that deal with becoming part of the world economy, such as the GATT, the International Chamber of Commerce, and so forth?
Well, thank you. I begin with the last part of your bipolar question, because it is much more simple to answer. Russia has actively participates in World Economic Organization. It was adopted to the World Bank, and Russia has a co-director of the World Bank. By the way, it was until recently no less than Boris Fyodorov, who now became our new Gaidar, and is a deputy head of government dealing with macroeconomics, with financial problems and so on. Russia is a member of in IMF, International Monetary Fund. Russia is member in some regional organizations, and we are preparing to enter in World GATT organization, Organization on Tariff and Trade, International Organization on Tariff and Trade. So we are actively participating in them in all Bretton Woods system. As for our relations with Europe, it is a long story. You are quite correct when you are saying that Europe is closer to us territorially, in territorial area than the United States, if not taken into consideration that we are close across the Pacific between two marginal extreme closest islands are only 4 miles, and one miraculous lady once swam it from your, it was American ladies, by the way, from your island to our island, despite all cold. So Europe is very close to us. And of course, naturally and historically, we have very natural trade, economic, and cultural relations with Europe. Now we develop it. Such countries as Germany, is very active in providing us with some economic assistance and in trading with us. Finland is very active, Italy, and so on and so forth. We have very good relations with them. We participate in European regional organizations. But I would tell you frankly that we are not happy if, for example, in 5 years, when our market economy will be strengthened, we will have somehow monopolized relations with Europe on the West, when, let us say, German capital, this is more powerful capital, will predominate in the Western part of our country. And let us say Japanese and Korean capital will be preeminent in the Eastern part of our country. Such scheme doesn't satisfy us for natural reasons, so we are very much interested in the increasing flow of American capital. We understand
that you are have your own internal problems, that you have problems with our legislation, with our political instability and so on. But don't miss this opportunity, because the point of irreversibility is has been passed in our country from communism to development toward market economy. In 4 or 5 years, it will be the richest market in the world. It will be a Russian economic miracle, just as it was in Japan, first in Europe after the Second World War, just as it was in Japan a little bit later, though after Second World War, Japan was in shambles much more than Russia now, and then it was in Asia, in some other countries in the Asia. I am sure that if you come too late, if you come too late, you come to the place which is occupied by many, many, many others.
Your second question, you can repeat it.
Yes, please, remind me, please.
So my second question was whether you favor the creation of a joint Russian-American military force under United Nations auspices for trouble spots.
Well, we not only support this idea, not, of course, as an idea of Russian-American bilateral forces, but as international forces with a good participation of the United States and Russia. We practically participate in such forces. For example, our forces participate in Yugoslavia as a peacekeeping forces. They stay in Croatia, our forces are ready to participate in some other crisis situation. Today, I delivered a message to General Secretary of Organization of American States, where President Yeltsin accepts the idea to participate in a demining of Salvadorian areas, which stayed after the civil war there, together with, of course, United States forces and some others. So we are willing to actively cooperate in peacekeeping operations together with United States and other countries.
Yes, ma'am.
Ambassador Lukin, I hold in my hand a copy of an article in the Baltimore Sun this morning that reports that Eastern Europe, including Russia, the people in these countries are starting to become disillusioned with democracy. 33% of the people in Russia, according to this poll, are disillusioned with democracy and expect the nation to revert back to a dictatorship, or back to dictatorship. Two questions. One, do you think this dictatorship would come in the form of communism or another form of dictatorship? And do you think Russia will indeed revert back to dictatorship?
Well, first, the polls are encouraging for me. For example, I belong to the 57%, not 43. No? secondly, you know, you should understand better, I would say, the psychology and historical mentality of some other countries. Russia as a country, as a people, as a nation, practically never experienced democracy. For millennium, Russia was authoritarian and then totalitarian state, with a very short interval of few months in between spring and autumn of 1917, when there was an interim democratic government, but very weak one. For 3 generations, we lived under totalitarian rule. So, you, with your Voice of America, your own experience, told us that democracy means happiness, democracy means very high living standards, and so on and so forth. We believed you. For example, I was elected to the Russian parliament because I told my district that I am ready to demonstrate what means the American living standard, the Japanese economic miracle, and so on and so forth. you know, human conscious is very concrete now. For example, what would you say if, for example, your president, a president, said that his program is very good and he produced some increase of your living standard, but in, let us say, 1 year or 1 year and a half, your living standard, prices increases 26 times and your wage increases 10 times. What would you say about it? So what is surprising, not this 43%, but that our population, where they're not understanding that democracy is not an instant happiness, but democracy is a very difficult road without any fixed goal. But during this road, you can use your opportunities, your individual forces, to increase your own load, to pay more money to the state and to make your state more powerful and so on and so forth. There is no experience, no such experience. There is only one experience, that Democrats came to power and the result, as I just described to you. So that is the problem. And it is a very serious. And it is answer to your next part of your question. Where the dictatorship is possible? I am sure that for former communist dictatorship is impossible. And in this way, I told you, and I repeat to you, that we crossed the line of irreversibility. But some other difficulties, some other attempt to construct some transitional, renewed nationalistic dictatorship are quite possible. And that is why I am far from trying to tell you everything will go very good under all circumstances. No. We should do it by ourselves, we should improve our economic load, we should improve our social conditions, but we need help. No other, not help in terms in terms that your taxpayers should spend something on it, but in some other areas we discuss it. If we will not be involved, if Western world will not be involved in our country, well, you will be involved in the next Cold War, and you will pay money for your own useless, now useless armaments. So it is a real problem of the world. It is a not. I don't try to terrify you, but it is a real situation. That is why I think that there are many fences on our road to the democracy. But I think the most important thing, the throwing out of communist dictatorship, the most terrible and the most the most powerful dictatorship in the world. It is a great victory.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Mr. Ambassador, Ukraine seems a little reluctant to give up their nuclear missiles and
at last.
And signed a non-proliferation treaty and the Nuclear Indemnification Act. What pressure, if any, is Russia putting on Ukraine to do these things? Also, what political pressure is Russia putting on the United States to accept or to raise the quotas for the importation of highly enriched uranium?
Well, on your first question, why pressure? Does it mean that you instigate us to produce our great power chauvinism toward Ukraine? The ironic thing is a few months ago, when we questioned some parts of Ukrainian behavior, there were outcry here, and I was mentioned too, that there are some chauvinists, some anti-Ukrainian feeling. Of course, I have no anti-Ukrainian feeling, just on the contrary. Now, when United States has problems with Ukraine, they say, what Russia will do with Ukraine? Nothing, of course. Nothing, because they are our friends, our neighbors, and so on. So we will convince them that it is in accordance with their own national interest not to create a situation where We have problems with them. United States have problems with them. Poland has problems with them, but he is far from being happy with the Ukrainian nuclear power and so on and so on. That is why I would say that there will be no individual pressure, but we should together convince them. And I think that United States has more levers than our country in doing with the Ukraine, because Ukrainian mentality is such that everything Russia does now, it is somehow treacherous attempt to subvert Ukraine. So I think the most important part of if tackling this problem is on the United States and European countries, because Ukraine now in its worst economic situation than Russia, and they simply cannot survive economically without your assistance, without Russian assistance, by the way. So we should convince them, taking into consideration this important factor. But convince is very important, because NPT treaty is very important. It's no less important for the United States than for Russia and for Europe and so on and so forth. So it is our common work.
I apologize to those people who still have questions. We do bow to the tyranny of time, and we must end our session promptly at 10:07. So because of that, that was my heartfelt desire that silly Freudian slip. But we must end by 10:07. And so let me thank the ambassador on behalf of all of you for a marvelous evening.